show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory.
Well, good morning, Wesley Heights Baptist Church, both here and at home. It's Palm Sunday, opportunity to worship. This week, as you read through the story of the Passion Week, you may go up and down emotionally with the geography of that experience, both from the Mount of Olives down into the valley and up to Jerusalem. But in the midst of that, remember the joy, the focus of this month, and the joy of worshiping on Palm Sunday. Hosanna in the highest. Highest, the King of, the Son of David, the King of Kings has come. Let us worship him as we come together this morning. We come together to worship corporately, but we come together individually. And we'll have a story about a woman who learned what it was to worship individually as well this morning, as we come to study a little bit about the woman at the well, who said, come, see, listen, understand this person who knows everything about me. A woman who was rejected, probably abused, but came to understand that although rejected by others, she was loved by the Savior. Let's read the story. It begins in chapter 4 of John. And specifically, I'm beginning to read at verse 4. And it came to pass, he came to pass through Samaria. So he came to the town of Samaria called Sychar, near the field that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Joseph's well was there. So Jesus, wearied as he was from his journey, was sitting beside the well. It was about the sixth hour. A woman of Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, give me a drink. For his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, how is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink of me, a woman of Samaria? For the Jews had no dealings with the Samaritans. Jesus answered her, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, give me a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water. The woman said to him, sir, you have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock. Jesus said to her, everyone who drinks of this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I give him will never be thirsty again. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water, welling up to eternal life. The woman said to him, sir, give me this water so that I may not be thirsty or have to come here to draw water. Jesus said to her, go call your husband and come here. The woman answered him, I have no husband. Jesus said to her, you're right in saying I have no husband, for you have had five husbands, and the one you now have is not your husband. What you have said is true. And the woman said to him, sir, I perceive that you're a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, but you say that in Jerusalem is the place where people ought to worship. Jesus said to her, woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither in this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming, and is now here, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. The woman said to him, I know that Messiah is coming. He was called the Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things. Jesus said to her, I who speak to you am he. Just then his disciples came back. They marveled that he was talking with a woman, but no one said, What do you seek? Or why are you talking to her? So the woman left her water jar and went away into town and said to the people, Come, see a man who told me all that I ever did. Can this be the Christ? They went out of the town and were coming to him. Let us pray. Our Father, we bow in your presence. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Help us in our worship today to be conscious of the presence, the holiness of God, in order that we may also capture a sense of his joy. We come, our Father, confessing. We confess that we're fickle. Like some of the crowd on Palm Sunday who were saying, Welcome to the King. And a few days later, we're part of the crowd that were saying, Crucify him. We confess that we're fickle. Sometimes on Sunday things are good, but during the week, not so good. We thank you, our Father, that like the woman at the well, even though you know all about us, you don't reject us, you're willing to forgive us. We come before you with adoration for your goodness to us as a church, as families of the church, and as individuals. We come with supplication. We're asking, our Father. We are needy. We have some of our family that are in hospital right now. We have some of our family that are battling aspects of cancer. We've got people with fibromyalgia, and we've got people that have brain tumors. We've got people who are suffering from long COVID. And so, our Father, we're asking for your grace to be their experience. But there are others in our family who are suffering because of difficulties in relationships. And we're asking, our Father, for your strong grace to be their portion. We've got people who are struggling with their faith. And so we bring them before you and ask, our Father, for the work of your own Holy Spirit in their lives. We are coming, our Father, to you with thanksgiving for who you are, not only for what you do, but for your goodness to us. We bow in your presence, asking, our Father, for you to speak to us today. What a privilege to celebrate the coming of the King. What a privilege to gather around the table to celebrate the purpose of the coming of the King. So help us today just to remain focused upon the person of Jesus Christ and his accomplishments in our lives. Grant to our pastor a sense of your presence also as he shares with us the word of God. For we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, thank you, and welcome to Wesley Heights Baptist Church. You'll notice that we're on a slightly different order of service here. I asked David to rearrange the service to have me preach first, and then the worship team is going to come up. And I hope by the end of the sermon, you'll say, I know exactly why he did that. That was a very appropriate thing to do. Well, we're in week two of a new series called Joy. Last week, we looked at the fact that God is joyful. He was joyful last Sunday. He's joyful right now. He'll be joyful next Sunday. Of course, that introduces an objection. Wait a minute, how can he be joyful when Russian bombs are exploding over the heads of innocent Ukrainian people? How can he be joyful when he looks at the wickedness of our nation and celebrating sin? That's for next week. We're going to solve all that next week. But this week is, we can enter into this joy. First week, God is joyful. The second week, and we can experience that joy. Friends, I don't want to leave this without just pointing out to you what huge news that is. You have a human heart, and that human heart is seeking happiness. I have a human heart. It is seeking happiness. Do you know that everything you do, is your effort to seek out happiness. Everything I do is my effort to seek out happiness. You know, some people here are very diligent. You're a hard worker. Why are you a hard worker? Because that's your effort to seek happiness. You in your mind say, look, if I'm diligent, I'm going to be rewarded. I'll have employment, security. I'll have money. I'll have the admiration of others. I am diligent because that is my effort to gain this happiness that I was built to crave. Some people are not diligent. As a matter of fact, you might even say they're lazy. Why are they lazy? Because that's their effort to be happy. Listen, if I'm lazy, I get to use my time the way I want to. And by the way, the harder you work, the more work you get. It doesn't really make that sense. And I don't have all this physical discomfort of having to do this work. Everything we do, whether we're conscious of it or not, everything we do is to seek out joy and happiness. This morning's sermon is, that's possible. That's possible. What our heart wants the most, what we spend every waking moment looking for, is findable. You know, there was a philosopher, Blaise Pascal, he said, all men seek happiness. This is without exception, every one of us. We woke up this morning, whether we're conscious of it or not, we woke up this morning seeking happiness. He continues, whatever different means they employ, they all tend to this end. We're all different. We all seek happiness in different ways. One person does this and one person does that, and they look so different, and they are different. But underneath it is the same drive. I want to be happy. I'm looking for joy. He says, the cause of some going to war and of others avoiding it, it's the same desire in both, attended with different views. Why do some people go to war? Because they think it'll make them happy. They will give themselves to a cause that is more important than them. They will have an esteemed position in the society. They will avoid perhaps the punishment of the government for not reporting to war. And they want to live in a highly regimented. They're going to war because they think, with given their current circumstances, that's what will make them happy. And why do some people avoid war? Because they think that's what will make them happy. I don't want to be in that physical danger. I don't want to live in that regimented world. He says the cause of some going to war and of others avoiding it is the same desire in both, this human need to be happy, to find joy. He says the will never takes the least step but to this object. We may not be completely conscious of it, but everything we do, the key to understanding our own behavior is to see that we are doing everything that we can do to find this happiness, to find this joy, that we were born with this desire to have. This is the motive of every action in every man. This is not a Christian truth. This is a human truth. When you watch a movie, a fictional movie, it is the story of characters all looking for joy and happiness. And they go through different things and they say different things and it creates conflict and the conflict is resolved. The human story is just us looking for joy and happiness. As a matter of fact, I'd like to show you a clip of a movie, one of my favorites, from Star Trek, wouldn't you know it? In this movie, Star Trek, this is the movie called Generations, there's an energy ribbon roaming through space, and there's a villain. The villain's name is Sorin, and he's about to do something terrible. And in this scene, the wisdom character of the movie, Guinan, explains how the villain and the ribbon are connected. Watch this.
Orion, over 300 years old.
He lost his entire family when the Borg destroyed his planet. Sorin escaped with a handful of other refugees aboard a ship called the Lakul. That ship was later destroyed by some kind of energy ribbon. But Sorin and 46 others were rescued by the Enterprise B.
That was a mission where James Kirk was killed.
I checked the passenger manifest of the Lakul. Guess who else was on board?
Sorin is a name I haven't heard for a long time.
You remember him?
Yes.
Guinan, it is very important that you tell me everything that you know. We think that Sorin has developed a weapon. A terrible weapon. One that might even give him enough power to destroy
him. Sorin doesn't care about weapons or power. He just cares about getting back to the Nexus.
What's the Nexus?
The energy ribbon that destroyed that ship was not just some random phenomena traveling through the universe. It's a doorway to another place that we call the Nexus. And it's a place I've tried very, very hard to forget.
What happened to you?
It was like being inside joy. As if joy was something tangible and you could wrap yourself up in it like a blanket. And never in my entire life have I ever been as content.
And then you were beamed away from there.
Pulled. Ripped away. None of us wanted to go. And I would have done anything, anything to get back there. And once I realized that wasn't possible, I learned to live with that.
What about Sorin?
If he's still obsessed, he could be a very, very dangerous man.
Why would he destroy a star? Thank you, Guinan.
If you go, you're not gonna care about anything. Not this ship, not Sorin, not me, nothing. All you'll want is to stay in the Nexus. And you're not gonna want to come back.
happening in the story? There's this thing called the Nexus that will transport you into the joy you've been looking for, and Soren was in it and then got pulled away and is spending the rest of his life, no matter what the consequences are, to get it back in the Nexus. We are all built to crave this because it will give us what we want the most. Later in the movie, Captain Picard, the male lead there, gets into the Nexus, and the Nexus gives him what he wants the most. I'm going to show you that, but just a word of explanation. If you watch Star Trek, you realize that Picard, although he's the hero figure, he has one deep regret. He never got married, he never had kids, and although he finds his role as captain of the Starship Enterprise very fulfilling, he always craves this family life that he never had. Now, in this particular movie, before this scene I'm going to show you, he's got some very bad news. His nephew, Rene, has died in a terrible house fire. This strikes him because he's lost a family member, but also Rene is the last male member of the Picard family other than himself. And so he realizes that this is the last generation for his family. Because he never had a family, because he never had sons, the name will die with him. So when he gets into the Nexus, what does the Nexus give him? What he wants the most.
Were you scared? Look at the tree.
I helped decorate it.
It took all day.
Say Merry Christmas, Papa.
See the presents?
I love you, Father.
I love you.
Come on, children, let's move back and give your father some room.
Cup of Earl Grey.
That will be perfect.
This one's for you.
Oh, thank you very much, Renee.
Merry Christmas, Uncle.
And Merry Christmas to you too.
Renee, can you help me with the table?
Renee. Come here.
Friend, the good news of the message this morning is that we are all built for the Nexus, and it is possible. Can you imagine the frustration that life would be if we were all built with the overwhelming desire to be NHL hockey players? Friends, that's not going to happen. There's age restrictions. You can be too young. There's talent restrictions. I think there's gender restrictions. I don't think women are allowed to play in the NHL. For you can have this deep feeling that I just have to be in the NHL, but it ain't going to happen for most of us, maybe for all of us. Life's not like that. We were built for joy and happiness, and it can happen. It can happen because the ultimate joy that is available for us is rejoicing in who God is. What does that even mean? Rejoicing in who God is. Like, that sounds like religious double talk to me. It isn't. It isn't. True joy is possible for you, what you've been looking for your whole life, the reason why you do everything. True joy for me is possible. What I've been looking for my whole life that explains all my actions. By finding the Lord and rejoicing in who He is. Hear the psalmist this morning. Will you not revive us again that your people may rejoice in you? Rejoice, root word joy, in you. Not in what you do necessarily. Not in what you give us. We don't rejoice in the bumper crop. We don't rejoice in the health that you gave us, because sometimes He doesn't give bumper crops. Sometimes He doesn't give health. We rejoice in you, The joy that we're looking for is actually in you. Hear the psalmist this morning. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Now, what the Lord does is good. What the Lord says is good. But this verse is talking about the Lord himself. He is good. He is not inviting us to a joy party. He is the joy party. And when we taste him, we will find everything that our human heart has always desired. Listen to the psalmist this morning. Satisfy us in the morning with your steadfast love. Not necessarily the things that you give us. Not necessarily that history is working out exactly the way we want. We want to be satisfied in the morning just with the fact that you love us, and it's steadfast. It's there this morning. It'll be there tomorrow. What would happen if we made it our business to be satisfied every morning in the steadfast love of the Lord? Then we would rejoice and be glad in all of our days. This is what we were built to look for. Hear the psalmist this morning. Restore to me the joy of all the money you've given me, the joy of all the health, the joy that everything is working out just the way. No. The joy of your salvation. The fact that we have been reconciled. The fact that there's nothing between us. The fact that we can have a relationship of love. That provides joy. We read the Bible, but not out of a sense of duty, out of a sense of joy. You know, Sandy and I, we've been married 36 years now, I think. We dated for 7 years before that. We wrote each other lots of letters. I lived in London for most of our dating time. She lived here in Toronto. So we wrote letters back to one another. You know, we still have all those letters. Why is that? Because those letters represent each other. I remember going, this is before email, this is before texting. I remember going to the mailbox every day to see if she had written me, and I still have those letters. We read the Bible not out of a sense of duty, but because we love the author. We can't wait to get more. We find them sweet to our taste, sweeter than honey to the mouth. Friends, the ultimate joy that we were built to look for is rejoicing in who God is. It's that simple. Wait a minute. First of all, it ain't that simple. I'm tracking with you, Pastor Don, but I don't live in that joy. I don't experience all that joy. If it's just a matter of saying, oh my goodness, God's the one I'm looking for, I'll just rejoice in him. Why don't I do it? Why don't I do it more consistently? Well, there's a problem. There's a problem. We have fallen. You have fallen. I have fallen. Our hearts have been sickened. We don't seek the things that we were built to seek, and therefore we don't find the joy that we were built to find. You know, I'm reading through the Bible this year. So I started in Genesis on January the 2nd and read through the creation account. Do you notice in the creation account that God comes in human form in the cool of the evening? And that Adam welcomes him, hey God, you'll never believe what I did in the garden. I got the back 40, we're already here. And they have intimate times together. Let's go name some animals, how about that? God says, have I got a surprise for you? It's a wife. Oh, bone of my bones. There's this wonderful intimate time. And then Genesis 3, sin. And God comes in the cool of the evening, and what does Adam do? Hides. There's something there. My desire is not for you anymore. I don't feel the same way about you as I used to. I'm not running to put my arms around you and say, God, thank you so much for coming. I'm hiding. Don't find me. And by the way, I put on clothing. There's a whole bunch of things about me you can't see anymore. These are private things. No. We're not there anymore. Why is that? Because of sin. Sin has corrupted our desire to find God. And when our first move in the search for joy is to remove God out of the equation, the equation becomes unsolvable. When we don't desire God, there is no happiness. There is no joy. And what we were built to look for is gone. This is why we settle. This is why we have eternity in our hearts and we want the joy of the Lord, but we'll settle for money. We desperately want the joy of the Lord, but we'll settle for popularity. We desperately want the joy of the Lord, but we'll settle for academic success. Why do we settle for these little baubles? Because to find joy in the Lord means desiring Him, and that's work. I want to talk for the rest of the sermon about this whole thing about desire. Will you help me? I want you to think about a time in your life where you have really desired something. I was talking to a woman in our church today, or this week, and her husband is an avid golfer. I think golf's almost every day in the summer. And she told me this week that he's driving by golf courses saying, soon, soon, that's desire. Or maybe your desire isn't to play golf, but you enjoy watching golf, and you can't wait to get back to the TV to see how Tiger's doing. That's desire. Or maybe you can remember a time where you made a very big purchase, and do you remember that excitement? Maybe it's a car, and you find yourself reading and rereading the brochure and looking at YouTubes and reading reviews, or maybe it's a house. And you call the real estate agent in and say, well, we've got to have one more inspection. You don't really need another inspection. You just want to see it. You're excited about it. Everyone asks you, hey, how are you doing? Just bought a house. Let's talk about it. Or maybe not a big purchase. Maybe a vacation. I was talking to someone this morning, and I said, I'll be very disappointed if you can't answer this question. They're leaving for vacation. I said, how many days? They knew. I talked to another person, met her fiancé this morning. I said, I'll be very disappointed if you can't tell me how many days. 140. 140. Why? Because I'm desiring that. I'm looking forward to that. Can't stop thinking about it. It's in my mind. I want to talk about it. Or maybe it's not a vacation. Maybe through COVID you have not been able to see a dear friend, but now you got plans. Now you're going to go see them. And you're in that state of excitement, that anticipation. Or maybe you can remember a time where you've been super hungry. Just for whatever reason, your schedule has been interrupted and you just haven't been able to eat for a day or two or three. I remember, you won't believe this, but I remember when I was younger, I used to play for our church baseball team. As a matter of fact, I was the pitcher. And we got to the finals, so we had a practice, and it was a hot Saturday, and I forgot to bring water. And it was a long practice. And of course, for everybody else, they're only involved, when they're batting or when they're fielding. I'm involved in every single pitch. Friend, I could feel myself getting more and more and more thirsty. I felt faint. All I could think about was water, getting some drink. And when the practice ended, I went right home and I just chug-a-lugged. All I could think about. Think of a time where you were in this state of desire. What you desire may be different from what I desire, but we will experience desire the same way. You can't stop thinking about it. You want to talk about it. I'll give you a personal example. Friends, this is the Anova Precision Oven. That's in your notes, kids. Anova Precision Oven. It's amazing. It controls the temperature. You know, the oven you have at home, when it says 350, that means 350 plus or minus 30 degrees. This thing is down to the half degree. And it controls the humidity. This is a water tank here, and it injects steam. And you can control it through the internet. Sandy and I have wanted one of these for some time, but they're a little outside of our snack bracket. When we were in Florida, we went to visit friends. They have a condo in Florida, so we arrived. Guess what's in their condo? The Anova Precision Oven. They make a supper. It's absolutely delicious. So, well, we've seen these. We would really like one. They're a little out of our snack bracket. Well, Brenda, the wife, says, well, maybe not. They're on sale for this week only and only in the U.S. Half price. So we bought one. We're living in a resort. There's no address. We give them the resort address, and they find the shipping thing. We don't know what's going to happen in shipping. We spend the entire day in the parking lot waiting for the truck to arrive. The shipper has an application. It says, like, 3 more deliveries, 2 more deliveries. It shows you where the truck is. We're looking at, is he moving? He took a lunch break, and we were super disappointed. So the oven comes. And by the way, while the oven's coming, I'm reviewing recipes. The oven comes, we take it right back to our apartment. My friend Ron, the guy that has the condo, is texting me, is it there yet? Did you get it yet? And I'm like 16. Yeah, it's just here. We can't wait to get it back. I send him a picture of our supper. I made ribeye steaks, and it was like keg quality. Like, I seared it on the outside, but it was medium rare on the inside. Like, it was just perfect. Sauteed red onions. Sauteed mushrooms and red onions. Homemade coleslaw. Friends, I am becoming increasingly aware that the key to my joy is to understand that God is the oven. He's my delight. He is my joy. He is the one I can't stop thinking about. The key to every morning for me is to put my heart in such a state that I desire and can't get enough of God. And when I'm in that state, I don't read the Bible because it's a duty. I read the Bible because I can't wait to read the Bible. I don't pray, oh man, I got to pray, and I'm the pastor, I got to pray. What am I praying about today? Okay, well, let's just get this over. I can't wait. The key to finding joy is desiring the Lord, because when we find Him, He provides everything that we've been looking for. This verse has been true for me in the past 2 months. For the past 2 months, I have woken up early and made it my business to put my heart in a state where it is desiring the Lord. And it's hard because I'm fallen and my heart keeps wandering. But this desiring state is described in the scripture. As the deer pants for flowing streams, so pants my soul for you, O God. Is that where your soul is? Are you panting for God like an animal who just can't think of anything until he gets to the water because he's so thirsty? My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. Is our soul so thirsty for God that it is the driving force behind everything? Because when it is, we will find Him. And when we find Him, we will find the joy that we were born and to desire and want. This has been revolutionary for me. And I have found that I'm not the first one here. This is not a Don idea. Turns out Christians have been discovering this for thousands of years. This is George Mueller. Lived in the 1800s. Saw the plight of orphans, and wanted to do something about it, so he started an orphanage, and he was so close to the Lord. He was just renowned for knowing the Lord and trusting the Lord. One day, he had 300 orphans under his care. One day, he wakes up, and the staff says, we have no breakfast. You haven't prepared breakfast? We don't have any breakfast to prepare. There is no food. You know what George Mueller did? He called the children in, and he sat them down in the dining room, all 300, and he said grace. He prayed a prayer of thanks for the meal that didn't exist. And after he finished praying, there was a knock on the door. He writes in his autobiography, Mr. Mueller, a baker knocked on the door. Mr. Mueller, he said, last night I could not sleep. Somehow I knew you would need this bread in the morning. I got up and baked 3 batches for you. I will bring it in. as the baker is bringing in the bread and is being distributed, it's the milkman. The milkman says, my cart has just broken right in front of your orphanage. And by the way, this is not a truck. There's no refrigeration. It's a wooden cart with some ice in it. He says, by the time I get someone here to repair the cart, this milk's going to be bad. Can I give it to you? There's 10 large tanks of milk. Do you know how many individual servings are in 10 large tanks of milk? Exactly 300. This is a man who just emanates faith in the Lord. What was his secret? Like, I want some of that. What was his secret? We don't have to guess. He wrote an autobiography, 750 pages autobiography, and in it he says this, I saw more clearly than ever that the first and great primary business to which I ought to attend every day was to have my soul happy in the Lord. That's the first thing I'm going to do. Is I'm going to put myself in a state where I am happy in the Lord. The first thing I ought to be concerned about was not how much I might serve the Lord, how much I might glorify the Lord, but how I might get my soul into a happy state and how my inner man may be nourished. And friends, that's why I've asked to reverse the service. It's entirely appropriate to praise the Lord in church, but not because we have a duty. And, you know, our guys, they've prepared some songs. Come on, guys, sing! That's not it. This is an overflow of joy. We praise because it's an overflow of joy. When you delight in something, don't you want to talk about it? Don't you want to sing about it? Here we are. My oven, it controls the moisture. Over temperatures, it is the rule. My oven is inside my kitchen and is unbelievably cool. When we're happy about things, we want to sing about them. Praise is not a duty. It's an overflow of delight. God doesn't demand our worship because he's a small, little, insecure God, and he needs a compliment, and he needs it right now. God commands us to our worship because he knows that when we worship him, it will complete our joy. Have you ever eaten a meal without swallowing? Swallowing is the consummation of the enjoyment of the meal. Have you ever watched a really great movie and not told anybody about it? Telling somebody about it completes your enjoyment of the movie. When we worship God, we complete our enjoyment for him. Kids, in your notes, praise is the overflow of joy, and that's why we go to the altar of God, to God our exceeding joy, and we praise him. Just one last point. Deacons, we're going to ask the band to come up and lead us in worship, and we will overflow in our praise for God. But when we come to the last song, which is Hosanna, praise is rising. Deacons, please join me at the table, and we will celebrate communion.
Please stand.
That ballad about the oven's going to be hard to follow up. Let's respond, as Don said, not because we must, not because the Lord commanded it, although he did. Let's respond as an outpouring of our joy. Let's sing Joy of the Lord.
Tears may fall, my song will rise to you. Though my heart may fail, my song will rise to you. While there's breath in my lungs, I will praise you, Lord.
We're used to singing at the beginning of the service in this church. Kind of gives us a chance to wake up. But I think we did a pretty good job there. Let's continue our worship this morning by singing, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins they are many, but His mercy is more. Let's sing together.
Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Could remember the wrongs we have done. Omniscient, all-knowing, He counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Mercy is more. so tender is calling us home. He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Of kindness He lavished on us. His blood was the payment, His life was the cost. We stood neath the debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more.
Sing praise.
Praise the
be Palm Sunday without singing Hosanna, praise is rising. So let's join together. We don't have palm branches this Sunday, but if you feel so inclined, you know, wave those imaginary palm branches around. I see some people. Yes, let's do it.
Hosanna, Hosanna,
when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away.
Seated. Friends, we are going to have an opportunity now to delight in the Lord. And I would just focus your minds on your own sin. Thanks, guys. Are you giving thanks for the bread today?
I am.
Okay. Focus your minds on your own sin and delight in the forgiveness of God. Can you imagine how difficult life would be if God weren't the way He is, who just said, "We're good. I have paid for your sin. What do I have to do to earn my way back?" You don't have to do anything. Well, we'll kind of be on the outs for a little while until you kind of forget about that. We're not on the outs. We're good. God is completely forgiving. We can delight in that. And we will delight in it in experiencing the element of the bread. Mr. Chairman, could you lead us in prayer?
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we are reminded as we're celebrating this morning, as we come before one, that we are back celebrating in this way together. And whether you're at home and you have a cup of orange juice and a loaf of bread, or whether you are today with the wafer and the cup here, Lord, it's not about the elements, but it's about what they represent. And not only what they represent, but what our hearts. So this is a time for us to do a self-reflection. It's not about our neighbor or our families or what we're doing afterwards, but it's about self-reflection on how our relationship is with you. And Lord, if there are things in our lives, and there are, that we need to ask forgiveness for, to make our relationship right before you, that we can experience that joy that we are talking about, that we can desire you each and every day, Lord. May that be our prayer today for our own lives. May we desire you each and every day. And as we remember the bread, whether it's a wafer, a piece of bread this morning, or whatever we are using to represent your broken body, that we are looking forward in this week of you dying on the cross and then rising again 3 days. Lord, help us to remember the broken body and what it represents to us, that you paid the price for our sin, that we can be in relationship with you, that we can be joyful relationship with you, and that we can desire each and every day. So thank you this morning for the opportunity to celebrate together and remember your broken body by partaking in the bread. In your precious name, amen.
Amen. Good job.
The Lamb who was slain, holy, holy is he.
Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. I will adore you.
For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Brothers and sisters, let's delight in the forgiveness of the Lord and ask for his grace as we model that forgiveness to others. And now I'd like to ask Liv Bon to give thanks for the cup.
Let's bow our heads in the prayer. Father God, we thank you for the position that we find ourselves in this morning. We are grateful for the fact that for the last 2 years we have been through COVID, and on an individual sense, and also as a body of believers. But all through it, you were there with us. You upheld us. You kept us sound, and we thank you for that. Ultimately, we know that that you are the God who we trust and we can depend on, and we worship a God of design, a God of purpose. And you have came into our lives and given us the joy that we wouldn't have had if we didn't know you. So we also thank you for that. And as we look forward to this coming year, Father, we just ask that you would continue to open our eyes to see things how you see things, the things that you delight in, the things that you get joy in. And we ask also that as we sense your presence, may we also reflect that same presence with those around us, so that they also can see what's in us and they can get a sense of who you are by just looking at us. We're so grateful for this church here at Wesney, and we're just so grateful for the fact that we have godly men who take the time to worship you and demonstrate to the congregants who they are. We see our identity in you, not in the religion, but ultimately in reality. And you have presented to us all the things that we need to see in ourselves, so that as we go ahead and as we worship you, and others see how we demonstrate our love for you, that they too would come aboard and gravitate to you. So as we worship you and as we give you the praise, whether it's in our places of work, at our schools, at our and communities, that you would get the praise, because you are worthy. We are here to just demonstrate to you that we love you and we care for you, and you are who we want to emulate. Whether it's in our places of work, where we can demonstrate who you are by what we do. Even if we do our work well, that is a sense of honor and praise to you. And it's also a way of worshiping you. So as we spend the time here now and we give you praise and thanks, we ask, Holy Spirit, that you would use us in a powerful way to demonstrate to the world that we are followers of Christ. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, this is an opportunity to delight in the Lord. As we took the bread, we were delighting in his forgiveness. Can you imagine where we'd be if he didn't freely forgive us? Now, as we take the cup, I direct your attention to our future hope. He came once. He's coming again for you because of this cup. In the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death," when? "Until he comes." Brothers and sisters, let's rejoice in the Lord together. One of the things that kind of got discombobulated when I asked David to completely change the order of service is I didn't want the announcements to be before the sermon, but we do have a few announcements, and I'd like to ask Malachi to come up and give those now. And Wendy Tomlinson, who's not even in the country, has an announcement. And Malachi, when you're making the announcements, just instruct us on what we do with our plastic cups. Malachi?
Thanks, Pastor Don. It's such a privilege to be here this morning just worshiping and just to understand how we have joy. That's such a powerful thing. So that explains my behavior all these years, just being a joyful, crazy person. So we thank God for that. We're just going to have the ushers come around and just pick up the empty containers, so just pass them off to the gentlemen as they come through the aisles for you. As Pastor Don mentioned, we have a number of announcements this morning, and we have a whole collection of people making the announcements. So first of all, the first announcement will be made by Wendy Tomlinson. Just watch the screen, please.
Good morning, Wesley family. I wanted to give a women's ministry announcement, even though I am away today. I wanted to invite you to a really special event that is happening on Saturday, April the 23rd, 2:00 in the afternoon. We've got a special guest coming to speak to us. Her name is Vanessa Brobel. She's from an organization called The Voice of the Martyrs. Some of you might be familiar with them. They are a ministry that helps and encourages and shines a light on the persecuted church around the world. So she's going to be talking to us a little bit about what's happening around the world. She's going to be talking about how we can be bold in our own faith where we live, and doing a couple of really hands-on practical things that we can help out with. She's actually going to instruct us on how to write a letter to someone in another part of the world who is either in prison or being persecuted in some way. She's also going to talk to us a little bit about their project, providing Bibles for Ukraine. So it's going to be very interesting. I think it's going to be very relevant. I think it's an important topic for us with what's going on in the world today. We so encourage you to come and be part of it and maybe to invite someone. Daughters are welcome, sisters, moms, relatives, friends, family, whatever you would like. We are going to have some time where it's just refreshments and enjoying time together, a chance to connect and chat and maybe meet someone new as well. And so because of that, we really do need to know who's coming so that we can plan for food and plan for tables. So if you can talk to Cheryl Rendell while I'm away, she's going to be taking registrations. If she's at church today, see Cheryl. If not, her email address is cheryl@wesney.ca. We would love to see you there. All of the details are on the church website. Saturday, April the 23rd. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I've just been reading through Revelations, just the first few chapters, and I read something that I'd never noticed before. When the 24 elders and the four living creatures are worshiping God and the Lamb, they have in their hands a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which represents the prayers of the saints. And I love that image, the idea of praise, a harp, coming together with prayer. That's just such a powerful image. And so that's what we're going to be doing tonight. We invite you to join us here at the church at 6:30 p.m. for our praise and prayer night. It's our way of starting off Holy Week with a joyful worship. We'll be singing some great hymns. We'll be having prayer time, praying for our church as we head into Holy Week. We have a few events happening. We're inviting other people from the community to come in, so we want to be praying for that. And we also have refreshments, and so please join us. We're going to be having prayer and praise tonight here at 6:30 p.m., followed by a time of light refreshments and desserts. Thanks.
Just a quick announcement about youth summer missions. I have applications for young people who want to serve in some capacity this summer. We have two opportunities. One in July is going downtown Toronto, working with ministries that work with homeless people and new Canadians. And that is open for youth who are sort of grade 8, going into grade 9, 14 years and up. We'll be staying downtown for a week. July 10th is the start date on that. Then in August, there's a missionary couple that used to serve in Kenya. They now live in Halifax, of all places, working with Africa Inland Mission, serving refugees from Africa. We're going to go to Halifax August the 13th to help run a camp for refugee kids who happened to land in Halifax, Nova Scotia, and there are full-time missionaries who are serving there. So if parents, just so you're aware, this is available to our young people. Also, congregation, please consider supporting our youth in this venture of learning to be a missionary. I call my little application Missionary Under Construction. Please talk to me if you're interested. Thanks.
Thanks, Pastor Bob. And just two final announcements. I was in McDonald's just this week waiting to order coffee, and there's a couple in front of me, and so they placed their order, and when the cashier mentioned the amount, which was about $45, I was quite shocked. I didn't realize you could spend that much money at McDonald's. But we have an even better deal for you, like a deal that you can't refuse. On the 30th of this month, we're going to have our spring banquet. Now, this is the banquet we usually have at Christmas time, but because of COVID, it hasn't happened yet. So we're going to have a spring banquet on the 30th, which is Saturday. And there won't be any burgers on the menu. We're actually going to have an amazing menu. So Neil, our master chef, is going to put together a really amazing meal. We also have a live band, the Masters 4 Quartet. They're going to be performing as well. And the tickets are $25 per person. So you can either see myself, Dave Riegert, who was here. He's going to be at the back of the, in the lobby at the end of church selling tickets. So please see David, myself, or Aunt Sandy when she's back. You can see her as well for tickets. So a really amazing deal. It's going to be a really fun night. It's going to be a night of fellowship, of great food, and a very good value. So we look forward to seeing everyone there on the 30th of, April, Saturday night at 6:30. And one other announcement. As you can appreciate, just like at your house, the lawn needs some raking, you need some garbage picked up, and you need to spruce up your house. Well, the church needs the same thing as well. So on the 23rd of April, a Saturday morning, we're looking for volunteers to help us to just clean up around the church, the grounds, all the garbage, plant some new flowers, rake the leaves or the grass, put down some fertilizer, etc. If you're interested in volunteering, can you see either Carl or Warren? And everyone knows Warren, I just don't stand. So people that know him, and Carl's over here. Oh, Carl's back right there. Sorry, Carl moved on me. Just see Carl or Warren after service to help us to clean up the church so the church will look nice for the summer. Thank you very much, Pastor Don.
Friends, just before I dismiss you, let me just acknowledge that perhaps the Holy Spirit has been speaking to you today, and there is some unfinished business. We have people that want to pray with you. I'd ask the prayer warriors to come up the forward right now, and if you're one of the deacons, please stand up. But we have asked people to make themselves available after the service today. If you would like to pray with a brother or sister who loves you, even if they don't know you, they love you, then all you need to do is loiter about the front after the service. They will find a quiet place somewhere in this building, and you can pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you for this wonderful time where we can celebrate who you are. Thank you for being so powerful. Thank you for being so wise. Thank you for being so forgiving. And thank you for the privilege of allowing our joy to overflow in praise, authentic worship to you this morning. We thank you in the name of the risen Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you, brothers and sisters. We'll be celebrating Easter. Well, see you tonight, then Good Friday, and we'll be celebrating Easter together next Sunday. Go in peace.
Stop the Lord.